Okay, welcome. So thanks for being here tonight. So this is a 2013 Frank Guarini government lecture. As you know, once a year, the law school brings a prominent government official to give this lecture. And our lecturer today is Meredith Fuchs, who, like Frank Guarini, is an alum of this law school. And she's the general counsel of the Consumer Financial Protection Bureau, and which has been in the news once or twice over the course of the last year or so. So we had great foresight in inviting her. Meredith is going to get introduced by the faculty director of the Guarini Government Service Program, my colleague Sam Raskoff. And I just want to say a few words about Frank Guarini, who is, for me, one of my all-time favorite law school alums. Frank is a model public servant. When we say that the law school sort of embodies these values of public service, it's hard to find a better example than Frank. He was a combat veteran in World War II, and then started, he had a very distinguished career in politics and elective office. He was a two-term state senator in New Jersey, and then served for seven terms in the U.S. House of Representatives, where he was a leader. And he was a leader at a different time, at a time when there was some more civility and some more cooperation, and Congress didn't seem like a place where people went to engage in armed combat, or unarmed combat. Frank cares deeply about education. He has founded Institutes and Centers at Dartmouth College, where he was an undergraduate, and at a number of other institutions, and we're very, very grateful that he had the vision to establish this program for government service here at the law school. As you know, the law school has a very distinguished public service tradition, but for many decades, most of our students thought that public service involved taking jobs where you sued the government. And that is, in fact, public service, but there are other forms of public service as well, and being in the government is obviously a very important form of public service, and Frank wanted us to focus on that. He has really transformed many of the things we do at the law school. I remember a conversation with Frank early on in my deanship. He explained to me that one cannot understand government unless one understands the politics of the budget process. Frank had served on the Ways and Means Committee. And that conversation stuck in my mind. And as you know, this year, our newest professor, David Kamen, before coming here, was at the White House as the president's special assistant on budget policy, and was described to me during the process when we were trying to recruit him as one of the half dozen people or so who knew the most about the federal budget. And he's actually designing a course on the federal budget here at the law school. The Guarini Government Scholars Program has done very well under the leadership of Sam Raskoff. We now have a seminar for the students. The students get placed in positions, mostly in the federal government. And as a result, Frank has really made us rethink an important part of our commitment to public service, and I'm extraordinarily grateful to him. This program, the Guarini program, has a splendid faculty director, my colleague Sam Raskoff. Sam was actually a student of mine, and we co-authored a piece together, and had a few months before he started his clerkship and came to the law school as a fellow and for us to finish this paper before he started clerking on the Second Circuit and the Supreme Court. And I think his first day on his job as a fellow was 9/11. And Sam and I went up to the top of D'Agostino Hall to the 14th floor and saw the first of the towers collapse. And that may have changed the course of Sam's career. I mean, we were writing about pedestrian issues of government regulation, and had decided that we would, at the end of his clerkship, before his Supreme Court clerkship, he'd have a few more months, he'd come back here and we'd write another one of these articles. But instead, he went to the Pentagon and then to Baghdad as the special assistant to Paul Bremer, who was then the head of the Coalition Provisional Authority. And Sam and Ambassador Bremer, surrounded by heavily armed phalanx, spent their time traveling around in Iraq. And following his clerkship, Sam was in private practice briefly, but then became the director of intelligence of the NYPD. So when we were trying to recruit him, he was a cop of sorts, probably the cop with the fanciest legal qualifications ever. But nonetheless, we were driving somewhere and he parked illegally and put his NYPD thing. It's been a while ago. I'm sure there is a statute of limitations for these kinds of administrative infractions. or it's probably fine. and Sam has been a wonderful colleague on our faculty and now the faculty director of our Center on Law and Security that has had an illustrious track record and is thriving under Sam's new leadership. So thank you, Sam, for all you do to promote public service and government service at the law school. And I'll leave you with the very nice task of introducing our guest speaker. Thank you.
Thank you, Ricky. And for the record, there was a perfectly good permit in the front of the car, a plaque, and as far as I know, it was an entirely legal affair. I would be remiss before I begin if I didn't say something about Ricky Revesz, who's been my dean the entire time I've been here at NYU, and as he just mentioned, was back in the day a teacher, a mentor, and along the years a friend. But as relevant to tonight's activity, I think Ricky has really transformed the law school in so many ways, but one way that I think is probably the most pressing or relevant to us here in the room is the absolutely tenacious commitment that Ricky has shown to public service and to an expansive concept of public service that encompasses not just suing the government, but actually serving in the government. You see that in the ARS/LRS class. You see that throughout the curriculum. You see that in the professors and faculty that Ricky's recruited. You see that in the programs, foremost among them, the Guarini program that brings us here tonight. So the idea that law school is a way into government life, public service is one of the great legacies of Dean Revesz. It's too soon to kind of speak in this elegiac tone because Ricky's still got time on the clock, but I think we ought to kind of be cognizant about the fact that the reason why NYU Law School in 2013 stands for government service the way it does is because of Dean Revesz. I would also be negligent if I didn't say at least one word very briefly about Frank Guarini, who is not only the benefactor of the program that brings us tonight's lecture, but also has become a mentor and a friend to me. And if I could pick a word that exemplifies what Frank Guarini's career and service is all about, it's grace. It's grace. He does what he does professionally, whether it's in government or in private practice and development. He does it with consummate grace. That has to do with his ability to connect to other human beings, his sense that public service and all of the good works that he does is inevitably about human interaction. It has to do with the generosity of spirit that he brings to these enormous projects that Frank undertakes. He's someone who's hands-on, but in an entirely kind of loving and caring way, the way that you would care about a family member. That's how he feels about the law school, and that's how he feels about the Guarini program here at NYU. I don't know that I've met someone who's as accomplished as Frank across so many domains, who's also as gracious and as graceful as Frank is. So thank you very much, Congressman Guarini, for all that you do for this law school. And now to our guest of honor and to tonight's speaker, Meredith Fuchs. As Ricky mentioned, a graduate of the law school, as is Frank. I think, there are a lot of things to say about Meredith, and I think the most important thing is actually to hear from Meredith tonight. That's why we're all here, after all. But I wanted to mention just two or three themes that I sense are kind of deeply a part of Meredith's professional life currently as general counsel of the Consumer Financial Protection Bureau. I know in my LRS class I tend to refer to three-letter agencies, but every once in a while there's a four-letter agency, and CFPB is certainly one of them. One of the, I think, important themes that connects up a lot of the work that Meredith has done across her career is the idea of range. And here, too, if I could mention one of kind of Ricky's signature commitments in public service doesn't necessarily have to be something you do forever. If you've gone to work in a private law firm, it doesn't mean that public service is now off limits because you've decided to go with the other side, right? My career is certainly not that way. Frank's career is certainly not that way. And Meredith Fuchs's career is certainly not that way either. In fact, she was a partner at a major DC firm before she got launched in her kind of current public service career, first as the chief investigative counsel of the Committee on Energy and Commerce in the House of Representatives, and currently as the general counsel of the CFPB. So if you're thinking of life as consisting of a binary choice professionally between working for the good guys and working for the bad guys, I think a little bit more nuance and complexity is called for. Public service is fully compatible with, may in fact be better if it's done as part of a career that encompasses more activity. In Meredith's case, not just private practice, but also NGO work, and dare I say it, Ricky, suing the government, including Meredith tells me suing the CIA. That must have been a trip. So there's range. Another thing that I think kind of unites Meredith's professional experiences is innovation. When she was the general counsel at an important NGO that I happen to be quite familiar with called the National Security Archive, one of her signature projects was trying to pry information from the government and specifically from parts of government that are not typically kind of minded to share that information with the public. And she did so not just kind of across the national security state, but also in the White House, and with a particular emphasis, if I'm not wrong, on technology and the ways in which electronic records, email, quintessentially, need to be preserved, need to be stored, need to be made part of the reservoir of knowledge of the government so that the people can ultimately have access to that. Nowadays, she's innovating again. I mean, as Meredith will, I gather, kind of tell us very shortly, she's the general counsel of what amounts to a brand new agency. And as Ricky mentioned, not an agency that has been kind of without controversy. So here she is, not just in an important position in government, but an important position in government on a range of issues that are hotly contested, and in an agency that's brand new and itself subject to a lot of political heat and controversy. So I think the idea of being in government as being compatible not just with private practice, but being compatible with innovation, with dynamism, with doing new things, with recognizing the role of technology, and also with acknowledging that controversy and politics are necessarily part of the equation, that's certainly been part of her career as well. And the last thing I would say, and this is something that I think is, you know, ought to be a mantra for everyone in the room, is that Meredith has been consistently committed to transparency. Now, we can quibble, I do often in the kind of my life as a national security law geek, we can quibble about how much transparency, what kind of transparency, and where, but I don't think there ought to be anyone in the room who thinks that the government should not, at least in principle, be committed to opening its records so that the governed can have a decent sense of what's going on inside of government. And I think that's something that Meredith was deeply committed to throughout her professional life before getting to her current job as GC, but also connects up with her current work. So without further ado, I present to you Class of 93 graduate Meredith Fuchs. Thank you so much for coming. Glad you're okay?
Thank you so much, Professor Raska, for welcoming me here. I graduated from NYU School of Law 20 years ago this May, which is somewhat shocking to me, but it's really wonderful to be back in Greenberg Lounge in Vanderbilt Hall, and it's great to be here with all of you. Congressman Guarini, thank you so much for sponsoring this program. It's an honor to speak at an event named after you with your remarkable accomplishments. My own government service is far less exciting, I think. However, it certainly has been the highlight of my professional career, and it's a privilege to serve in a position to serve the public. So it's great that you are sponsoring this program and the other programs and encouraging the next generation of public servants. So thank you. And Dean Revesz, I can say is you weren't the dean when I was here, but I've certainly spent the last many years hearing you speak about the law school and about all the tremendous accomplishments. So thank you for your service to the school and continuing to make it one of the most outstanding institutions to learn to be a lawyer at. So thank you, and I'm really delighted to be here. I'm sure with you, you're going back into full-time academia is going to be great for academic discourse, but the rest of us will miss you as dean. So this event embodies one of the reasons I came to NYU School of Law. This is a place where both public service and commercial private practice of law are equally valued and equally important. And as Professor Raskoff mentioned, I am someone who has done both. I have sued the government. I'm now in a position of being sued as a member of an agency in the government. And I don't think that it is a binary choice at all. In many ways, frankly, that appreciation for both the public and the private interests is at the heart of the work of what the Consumer Financial Protection Bureau does, and that's where I serve as general counsel. Many of you probably know that the Consumer Bureau was created in 2010 by the Dodd-Frank Wall Street Reform and Consumer Protection Act. Congress enacted that law in the wake of the greatest financial crisis since the Great Depression. New federal agencies are not created very often. When they are, it's usually because of some sort of disaster. For example, the Department of Homeland Security was created after September 11th. So what can we learn from the shock to the system that justified the creation of a new agency of the Consumer Bureau? Well, beginning in 2007, our country went through the biggest financial crisis of our lifetimes. Irresponsible underwriting of mortgages was the focal point and the principal cause of the crisis, and that led to a severe credit crunch and the near collapse of the economy. Most of the people in this room, you know, are fairly young. You're law students, but I certainly remember not that long ago how it felt with the anxiety about the greater economy. Entire neighborhoods were swamped with foreclosures. People, even those who had sensible mortgages, who'd been paying them for years, found that they were having trouble making their payments on time. And after half a century of steady appreciation in home values, in most areas, many people saw the value of their homes go down the drain. The societal impact was severe. And for the last 5 years, we've been coping with the impact of our housing market and wondering when we would begin to see recovery. This financial crisis reminded us in a very, very hard way that unregulated or poorly regulated financial markets can affect not only the welfare of individuals, not only the welfare of specific financial firms that make poor choices, but the stability of the economy itself. That credit crunch, the freezing of the financial markets, the lengthy recession, and the painfully slow recovery from it have been hard all around. The shock to the system was that was not just felt in the housing markets. It was felt in the employment figures. It was felt in the growth of our economy. The Bureau was created, among other reasons, to try to prevent this from ever happening again. Our mission is pretty straightforward. We make consumer markets work for responsible businesses and for consumers. That's the balance of the private and the public interests I mentioned earlier. Consumer finance, as you all know, as students probably incurring debt, it's part of the daily needs of the American public. Nowadays, you can't buy a home, buy a car, go to college without some sort of access to credit. And there is a staggering amount of consumer debt. $10 trillion in mortgage and real estate debt in the country. Over $2.6 trillion in non-real estate debt, almost $1 trillion of that, which is student loan debt. At the same time, the financial products and the services that we use are more and more complex. Most of us rarely read the boilerplate statements. We hope that the market and regulation of the market will work in our favor and push the creditors to be responsible so that we don't fall into the problems of the past. And, you know, just a few years ago, we saw that that strategy really doesn't work. Prior to the passage of the Dodd-Frank Act, the consumer financial protection functions were scattered across multiple federal agencies, the Federal Reserve Board, the Office of the Comptroller of Currency, the Federal Deposit Insurance Corporation, and the Department of Housing and Urban Development, to name a few of them. Most of those agencies were primarily concerned with the safety and soundness of the institutions they regulated, the banks. The Dodd-Frank Act created an agency dedicated to consumer protection and made us responsible for implementing 18 different consumer financial statutes, the Truth in Lending Act, the Home Ownership and Equity Protection Act, the Real Estate Settlement Practices Act, and the Fair Credit Reporting Act, amongst others. Importantly, the Bureau was also empowered to act against unfair, deceptive, and abusive consumer financial practices. We also were given jurisdiction over non-bank institutions, which had rarely been subject to federal oversight and not federal supervisory oversight. These non-bank institutions include entities such as payday lenders, mortgage servicers, debt collectors, credit reporting agencies, and others. Thus, we were charged with leveling the playing field and ensuring that non-bank lenders are subject to similar scrutiny as that imposed on banks. Banks had previously already been regulated in this way. So that part of the law, the extension to non-banks, at least, garnered a sigh of relief from the banks. Though we officially only opened in July 21st, 2011, Congress gave us several assignments to complete by a date certain. I'm going to talk about those today. Voltaire wisely observed that perfection is attained by slow degrees. It requires the hand of time. Well, we were not given any time. Spurred by the housing market collapse, Congress kept us busy working on 8 separate rules that dramatically alter the mortgage and lending environment. And they were due January 21st, 2013, 1 week ago, and we met all of those deadlines. Some of the people in this room may have helped draft rules. Some of you may have commented on rules. Some of you may have relied on rules in work that you've done. Speaking here today at the other side of proposing, receiving comments on, and promulgating 8 separate rules at the same time as an agency grew from 10 people in the basement of the Treasury Department to an agency of over 1,000 people, it's hard not to focus on what we've done in this last year. The mortgage market, which is the single biggest market for consumer finance, is worth trillions of dollars. It's a complex market, and regulating it is a very, very complex job. At the Bureau, we want to make sure that the rules that we write address the problems in the mortgage market, but are grounded in data and are grounded in the actual consumer experience of holding a mortgage. So we study reports, we meet with stakeholders, we listen to consumers about their struggles and their frustrations, and we analyze all of the available data. We know that the mortgage decision is one of those very few big decisions that can shape the direction and trajectory of your financial life forevermore. Homeownership is a key element of the American dream. But that dream can easily become an enduring nightmare if you cannot afford to make the payments on your home. And in each stage of the mortgage process, we found major problems that have hindered people from making good borrowing decisions in the ways that are best for them. So when the housing market collapsed, what was exposed was a range of severe consumer protection problems in the mortgage industry, problems that infected the underwriting of mortgages, the structure or origination of mortgages, and frankly led to unfortunate decisions by consumers. And as more and more consumers found themselves deeply underwater on their loans and struggling to choose which bill do I pay this week, my mortgage or one of my other bills, a tsunami of delinquencies overwhelmed the mortgage servicing industry. And mortgage servicers who manage mortgage loans, they play a really critical role in the lives of consumers and of homeowners. They collect and they apply the payments to the loans. They can work out modifications for problem loans, and they handle the foreclosure process. But when waves and waves of delinquencies were hitting, many of the servicers simply were unprepared to offer basic customer service. They were unprepared to work with individuals who had problems. people couldn't obtain information or advice about how to save their homes. And some of the servicers didn't answer the phone, routinely lost paperwork, mishandled accounts. And individual consumers sometimes thought that they were on the path to a solution, only to find that their homes had been foreclosed on and sold. There even are stories of people who arrived home to find themselves locked out. This marketplace, this servicing market, is a classic example of how the market position of the parties can affect the outcomes. Those of you who have mortgages, you may find that your lender is not the one who services your mortgage. It's usually a separate company, a separate mortgage servicer. They get your money, they deposit it, they credit your account, they pay your taxes, your home insurance premiums, and they're the ones you call if a check goes astray or if you want to know your payoff balance. You don't get to choose your mortgage servicer. Your lender chooses them. You don't get to choose the company to whom your bank sells your loan. Your lender chooses that. And if you're unhappy with your servicer, tough luck, because you can't fire them and you can't move your mortgage to another servicer. At the same time, the mortgage servicers would say that the mortgage servicing market is intensely competitive and they have to compete vigorously in order to keep the business of the lenders, and they're right. The incentives, however, do not work out that well for consumers, and experience suggests that customer service, from the consumer perspective, often got short shrift. So there were certainly many horror stories, some of them that we've documented and that you've probably seen in the press, of mortgage servicers who provided terrible service. Last year, our Office of Consumer Response received 47,000 complaints about mortgages. More than half were problems of people unable to make their payments on their homes, such as issues relating to loan modifications that they wanted, debt collection, foreclosure. We found that active service members who are by law entitled to lower interest rates and additional protections from foreclosure, in too many cases, those protections were simply ignored. And so even though these people were risking their lives in service to the country, they didn't get the protections to which they were entitled. Other people told us stories, like a woman from Arizona who told us she applied for a loan modification, she received the paperwork, filled it out, sent it in, and thought she was doing everything she could to protect her home. Next thing she knew, her home was in foreclosure, and the bank told her that they hadn't received her paperwork, and there was nothing they could do. Unfortunately, that woman was not alone. A coalition of federal agencies and 49 state attorneys general in February of last year reached a $25 billion settlement with the country's five largest mortgage servicers of claims arising out of an investigation into the widespread use of robo-signed affidavits in foreclosure proceedings. While robo-signing received the most attention, other servicer-related problems were identified, including deceptive practices in the offering of loan modifications. So, for example, telling a consumer that a loan modification was imminent while simultaneously foreclosing on their home. In some instances, unnecessary foreclosures occurred because of the failure to process homeowners' requests for modified payment plans or because shoddy documentation led to protracted delays in the effort to get a modification. So it's not a very pretty picture, and it affects people very directly. At first blush, it certainly sounds like an industry that badly needed regulation. And so Congress created the Bureau and instructed us to do what we could to prevent this from happening again. We just issued our first mortgage servicing rules, and which will achieve two main objectives related to this problem I've described. First, they'll help prevent borrowers from being caught off guard by surprises and getting a runaround by servicers. And second, they provide special protections for borrowers who are having trouble making their mortgage payments. But the responsibility to regulate in this way while accounting appropriately for both the consumer and the commercial interests is a challenging job. At the Bureau, we are trying hard to assess when regulation is warranted and to ensure that we have the right kind of regulation at the right point in time, because things change very, very quickly. Doing so requires good information, which we are acquiring. To quote from our strategic plan, the Bureau is a data-driven agency. Our aim is to use data purposefully to analyze and distill data to enable informed decision-making in all internal and external functions. To that end, one of the ways we seek to address the mission to protect consumers and to allow the markets to function so that honest businesses can compete is through a division called Research, Markets, and Regulations that's staffed by economists, market experts, social scientists, and attorneys. We are actively seeking information in field hearings all over the country and through outreach with the financial institutions. And so far, we feel fairly encouraged by the response to our outreach efforts, as some of our regulatees have complimented us on being good listeners. And we're also trying to be transparent, to your point. We were relying on new methods in our rulemakings that we hope increase public engagement and will improve the input that we receive. For example, we conducted extensive pre-proposal outreach to inform our job of consolidating the mortgage disclosure forms that people receive when they're about to make a purchase on a home. We used qualitative research with actual consumers and market participants, and we used web-based tools so that tens of thousands of Americans were able to look at the model forms and provide input on the design and the content of the forms. We're also participating in Cornell University Law School's e-rulemaking initiative to encourage greater citizen participation in the rulemaking process by making it more accessible and transparent through social media and other tools. I encourage you certainly to look at our website at consumerfinance.gov and see some of these efforts. I mentioned earlier, however, that we just issued 8 regulations, mortgage servicing being just one of them. We issued all these rules at once because Congress recognized that these excesses were so gross as to be dangerous for the nation. And while the laws passed in reaction to adverse current events may sometimes be poorly calibrated to preventing the harms at which they were aimed, many of the principles Congress enacted in the Dodd-Frank Act have common sense appeal. And it's our job as a regulator that's trying to have a broad impact on policy to implement and particularize Congress's intent in a way that works for consumers and for the businesses that are affected by the rule. So I wanted to just talk about one other example from the rules we just issued that, frankly, has been spoken about as the most important rule the CFPB has issued or will issue. To implement a key portion of the Dodd-Frank Act, the Bureau just promulgated rules that require mortgage lenders, before they grant a mortgage, to make a reasonable assessment of whether the consumer can actually afford to pay back the loan. This provision protects consumers for obvious reasons, and it also helps strengthen the housing market because it roots out reckless and unsustainable lending. It also should help responsible lenders by ensuring that they don't have to compete on an unlevel playing field with counterparts who offer deals that are just too good to be true. In a related provision, Congress also directed the Bureau to define a special category of loans where borrowers are presumed to be protected from the risk of taking on loans they can't afford. If you're a borrower of these so-called qualified mortgages, your loan won't include many of the toxic features that left people at risk of losing their homes during in 2008 and thereafter. The lenders who originate these qualified mortgages are granted a special degree of legal protection against lawsuits alleging that the lender failed to assess the borrower's ability to repay. When the ability to repay rule was issued, I was struck by how often commentators joked, lenders did not have to consider whether the loans could be repaid? But in fact, they did not always consider whether the loans could be repaid, and now that's going to change as a result of the rules issued by the Bureau. So I mentioned earlier the challenge that regulators face when they're calibrating post-crisis regulations. In the mortgage lending area, establishing the principles of responsible lending is only one part of our job. Responsible lending will only exist if there's lending in the first place. Today's mortgage market is so tight that even consumers with strong credit histories may not be able to borrow the money they need to buy a home. In drafting our regulation, our goal has been not only to end reckless lending, but also to enable consumers to have access to credit that they can afford. So we've taken several steps to ensure these requirements for safer mortgages will also preserve access over the long term and as the market adjusts. Our rules are designed to recognize that both consumer protection and access to credit and the needs of business for clarity and growth are all expressed through the rule. And we plan to spend time and resources on implementation in the next year to try to refine these rules and make sure that they are clear and that they work in the marketplace. So one of the regulator's jobs is also to try to anticipate and address problems before the next crisis. As demonstrated by the last financial crisis, this is not so easy to do. And so I am going to close by talking a little bit about what comes next for the CFPB. With this big job behind us of promulgating the mortgage rules, we still are just at the very, very beginning of our work. The recent mortgage rules, as critical as they are just a fraction of what we're focused on. We're a very energetic place, so I can only really touch on a smattering of the activities in the building, but I'm going to tell you a little bit about them. I mentioned in passing, for example, that we have authority over non-bank consumer finance companies, and they weren't previously subject to federal supervisory oversight. Well, we've issued rules that define segments of this industry, of the consumer reporting and the debt collection industry, that we are going to be examining for compliance with the law. We've also begun a study of mandatory arbitration clauses in contracts for consumer financial services that is much anticipated. We're also, I think I mentioned earlier about our data work, we're compiling significant data sets that will allow us to understand consumer debt in greater detail than ever before so that we can do a better job in the future of trying to protect consumers. We've developed an innovative consumer experience on our website to help students learn how to finance their education, and we plan to develop similar programs focused on other major financial decisions in the future. I encourage you to take a look at what we've done. We're trying to come up with new ways of engaging the public and helping to educate them about financial choices. We also have established offices that focus specifically on issues faced by older Americans, service members, students, and by underserved segments of the population. We are taking in and helping resolve tens of thousands of consumer complaints every year using an innovative interface between consumers, the Bureau, and the financial institutions. And we've been bringing enforcement actions, which already have resulted in more than $400 million in restitution to consumers harmed by deceptive financial services. As the market continues to change and grow, we have been charged with a duty we take very seriously to protect responsible lending for borrowers and lenders. We plan to continue to do so, and we plan to continue to carry out our mission. So thank you. I'd be happy for your feedback on the work that we're doing, and I'm happy to also take any questions.
Maybe I can start us off.
Okay.
Is that okay?
Sounds good.
You know, one of the themes, that's okay, I think you can hear me. One of the themes this semester in our Guarini seminar is integrity in government and in public life. We decided to tackle a small issue like that. I wonder if you could comment almost experientially about what it's like to be at the cutting edge of all these regulations in a climate in which there are people who are calling for the end of your agency, who are all full of vinegar when it comes to the job that you've set out for yourself and that your agency has. How do you operate in a climate like this? How do you get anything done in a world in which the opposition to what you're doing is as vigorous as it is?
So within CFPB, we tend to be a mission-driven crowd of people, and we're there because we want to make things better for consumers. We want to help make the marketplace work better. Our staff is not all people who come from a consumer background. We have people who come from Wall Street, who come from various financial institutions. It's really wide-ranging, and so there's not sort of an ideological slant, except we're all unified by our mission. While we certainly have had lots of attention focused on us over our 2 years, the endeavor of starting a new agency is so energizing and so unusual an experience that I don't think anyone ever slowed down and stopped to worry. We just tried to do the best thing we could do as well as we could do it. Questions, comments?
Randall. Right, go ahead.
I'm Charlotte Flamen. Thank you so much for coming to speak with us today. I'm wondering if you could tell us a little bit more about your role as the general counsel at the CFPB.
Sure, thanks for the question. Well, the CFPB has a lot of attorneys working at it in various roles. The general counsel is as the chief legal advisor to the agency. And part of what that means is making sure that we operate in a way that both ensures we are exercising our authority fully so that we're carrying out what Congress asked us to do, but we're also being careful to always be in compliance with the law, and we're being thoughtful about how we do that. So I always think of our lawyers as the ones who are providing kind of the most rigorous part of the legal analysis about what is okay for the agency to do. We have other lawyers who are policy lawyers who are coming at their projects as sort of driven on policy or thinking about the outcomes they want to achieve. And so we tend to always be analyzing what are the legal options to accomplish a particular outcome to help enable the agency to accomplish its work.
I guess I have more of a request than a question, which is, with the district or the DC Circuit's opinion last week about the National Labor Relations Board and the recess appointments, to the extent you can talk about it, how have things changed in your agency? What are some new tactics maybe you're trying? And what's the feel of, wow, like a lot of the work we've just done is, you know, what's gonna happen to that? And how are you addressing that as an agency?
Sure. Well, first of all, that case, as you know, involved the NLRB. It didn't involve the CFPB. And so it doesn't have a legal impact on the CFPB. But, you know, we operated before we had a director. We were engaged in supervising institutions. We had started working on the rules that we've just issued. And we will continue to operate regardless. I think at this time, we are focused on carrying out our mission, and there's a number of things that, you know, Congress specifically asked us to do. And if we have the authority to do them, and if we've been directed by Congress to do them, and we don't, that, you know, is a concern. So we're continuing to carry out the work that we're doing.
Thanks.
Go ahead.
Can you talk a bit about the issue of debt collectors and what the CFPB is doing about those institutions?
Well, the CFPB, debt collectors is one of the areas of non-bank financial institutions that the Bureau is empowered to supervise. It's an area that we have issued what we call a larger participants rule that defines the category of larger participants in the debt collection arena that we will engage in supervising. And for many people don't actually understand what a supervisory agency does. The banks are used to being examined by regulators, the Office of the Comptroller of Currency, the Federal Reserve Board of Governors, the Federal Deposit Insurance Corporation. They all examine banks, and that means they actually go into those institutions and they look at their books and they assess whether they're in compliance with the law. We call them the prudential regulators. They're really focused now that a large part of the consumer work has been moved to the CFPB. Their primary focus is on the safety and soundness of the banks. And that's they do similar work to what we do, although our work is probably almost all legally based because we're looking at compliance of the law. And so we will be, in fact, beginning to do examinations of debt collection companies. And this is certainly the first time they've been subject to this kind of federal oversight. So it is, I think, a change for that industry.
Let me ask you a question that maybe this is kind
So the fortuity of being at a brand new federal agency is something that is be hard for anyone to recreate. Fortunately, we don't have that many crises that cause new agencies to be started. Although I have to say, if you ever do have the opportunity to do something like that, I think any kind of startup environment is just really exciting, and you learn a lot from being in an environment like that. In terms of becoming the general counsel of a federal agency, I mean, I live in Washington, and I have always been a lawyer, and I think of myself as a litigator, although I haven't litigated cases in a couple of years now myself. But I think that you start by doing the best legal work that you can do, because when you do good legal work, it will be noticed no matter where you are, whether it's at an NGO or a law firm or in government. Number two, you try to enjoy what you're doing, and you do it with care, because and with caring about it, because that shows when you really have an investment in your work, when you take ownership of your work and you care about it. And you know, for a lot of these government jobs, a big part of getting an opportunity is just being there at the right time in the right place. That means you have to tell people you want to do it. You don't wait for it to happen, but you talk to people. You let them know what you care about. You let them know what you want to do. I recently was talking with a group of attorneys back at my agency about, we were reading an article about negotiation that our research group had sent around, and it talked about how some people will ask for more compensation in a job, and some people won't. It was talking about men versus women. And we all sort of concluded, you have to ask if you want something. And so if you're interested in going into a government job, you should show up at the door.
Get better advice than that. Yes, sir.
So right now we're studying arbitration clauses in consumer contracts. That's something that Congress asked us to do in the Dodd-Frank Act. They didn't, beyond studying, they didn't ask us to do anything. It's multi-phase. It's obviously an issue that is garnering lots of attention, and there will be a lot of attention paid to the work when we come out with it. But we're not far enough along yet that there's much to say about the results. I mean, we've done some information collection. We did a request for information in the Federal Register, and we've received information that we're analyzing.
So there's no opinion yet
on
what
direction?
No.
Well, I think we may have a hungry crowd tonight, so let's turn them loose on the treats in the back. And in the meantime, please join me in thanking Meredith Fuchs.